Good morning and welcome to St. James on this holiday weekend. We are calling the theme of this service the Gift of Nation Sunday, and we thank God for all the gifts that are before us. It is also the fourth Sunday of Pentecost, and today we will focus on the words of the first lesson from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Let us begin our liturgy with words of confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love endures forever.
Amen.
Let us now confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not followed your path, but have chosen our own way. Instead of putting others before ourselves, we long to take the best seats at the table. Our bad Bibles in need, we have so often passed by on either side. Set us again on the path of life. Save us from ourselves and free us from all our enemies. Hear now the good news. God does not heal us, does not deal with us according to our sins, but delights in granting pardon and mercy. It is in the name of Jesus Christ that our sins are forgiven. We are now set free to love as God loves. Amen.
Thank you.
us, the mother who comforts us. With your Spirit, accompany us in our life's journey and our nation's journey on this 4th of July weekend, that we may spread your peace in all the world. We pray through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Rejoice with Jerusalem and be glad for her, all you who love her. Rejoice with her in joy, all of you who mourn over her, that you may nurse and be satisfied from her consoling breast, that you may drink deeply with delight from her glorious bosom. For thus says the Lord, I will extend prosperity to her like a river, and the wealth of the nations like an overflowing stream. And you shall nurse and be carried on her arm and dandled on her knees. As a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you. You shall be comforted in Jerusalem. You shall see and your heart shall rejoice. Your body shall flourish like the black grass, and it shall be known that the hand of the Lord is with his servants, and his indignation is against his enemies. Word of God, word of life.
Thank you.
1 through 16. My friends, if anyone is detected in a transgression, you who have received the Spirit should restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness. Take care that you yourselves are not tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. For if those who are nothing think they are something, they deceive themselves. All must test their own work. Then that work, rather than their neighbor's work, will become a cause for pride. For all must carry their own loads. Those who are taught the word must share in all good things with their teacher. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for you reap whatever you sow. If you sow to your own flesh, you will reap corruption from the flesh. But if you sow to the Spirit, you will reap eternal life from the Spirit. So let us not go away in doing what is right, for we will reap at harvest time if we do not give up. So then, whenever we have an opportunity, let us work for the good of all, especially for those of the family of faith. See what large letters I make when I am writing in my own hand? It is those who want to make a good showing in the flesh that try to compel you to be circumcised, only that they may not be persecuted for the cross of Christ. Even the circumcised do not themselves obey the law, but they want you to be circumcised so that you may boast about your flesh. May I never boast of anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. For neither circumcision nor uncircumcision is anything, but a new creation is everything. As for those who will follow this rule, peace be upon them and mercy and upon the Israel of God. Word of God.
We wipe off in protest against you.
Yet know this, the kingdom of God has come near. Whoever listens to you listens to me, and whoever rejects you rejects me, and whoever rejects me rejects the one who sent me. The 70 returned with joy, saying, Lord, in your name even the demons submit to us. He said to them, I watched Satan fall from heaven like a flash of lightning. See, I have given you authority to tread on snakes and scorpions and over the powers of the enemy, and nothing will hurt you. Nevertheless, do not rejoice in this, that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven. The Gospel of our Lord. Please be seated. Today here at St. James, we celebrate the Gift of Nations Sunday, and as we stand on the cusp of 4th of July, I want to begin with a reference to history. See if you can figure out what I'm talking about. It took 17 years to write. It was published in two volumes in 1776 during the Scottish Agricultural Revolution. Its topic was economics. It touched on division of labor, productivity, and free markets. Alexander Hamilton used it. Karl Marx was influenced by it. It shaped our American Industrial Revolution of the 1800s, and it's still used in econ classrooms today. What is it? I'm referring to Adam Smith's work, The Wealth of Nations. It's known as classical economics today. And where, by chance, did this Scottish economist and philosopher get his idea and even his title for the book? Well, of course, from our first reading today, Isaiah, the 66th chapter. These words. For thus says the Lord, I will extend prosperity to her like a river, and the wealth of the nations like an overflowing stream. End of quote. The prophet Isaiah speaks to Jerusalem and says, God will restore you. God will bless you with wealth. Promise. But what if the promise seems hollow? What do we do when God's promises are not completely fulfilled? That isn't just a question of history. It may be our personal question that you and I walked in here with today. For Israel, 538 years before Jesus' birth, God's Hebrew people were exiled from their homeland for nearly 70 years. And finally, they returned to their capital city, but it was a difficult homecoming. Everything had been destroyed. The rebuilding of the temple was a great idea, but it faced constant delays. The city walls had been ruined and would lay ruined for over a century. Reconstruction was slow, and their spirits were dampened. Can God be counted on to fulfill God's promises? And the people cry, the Lord has forsaken me, my Lord has forgotten me. And that's when Isaiah the prophet steps back onto the scene and reiterates God's promise, I will extend prosperity to her like a river, and the wealth of the nations like an overflowing stream. For as a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you. So, like the people of Isaiah's day, how do you and I live in those in-between places? Between words and actions. Between promise and reality. How do we live in that spot, both personally and as a nation? Personally, for example, in the book of Hebrews, there are almost two chapters that speak of all the biblical characters and how they followed by faith, and their faith had brought them to God, and God was faithful to them. And then the text ends like this: all these died in faith, not having received what was promised, but having seen it and greeted it from afar. They too relied on a promise that wasn't completely fulfilled. And how about us as a nation? Our Declaration of Independence clearly and profoundly states a conviction, a statement that defines us as a nation. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal and are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights. Cherished words. That is, if you were a white male man. The promise wasn't fulfilled if you were female, or a slave, or had no property. Is it just a promise? Or by God, can we help to make it a reality? And how about the words of Emma Lazarus from 1883 in her poem that were placed at the base of the Statue of Liberty in New York Harbor welcoming immigrants? You know the words. Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse of your teeming shore. I lift my torch beside the golden door. Inspiring words of welcome and inclusivity. Was the promise fulfilled? Well, not if you were Asian American or dealt with a mental illness, you were told to turn around and go back home. Or today, if you're from Guatemala or Honduras, or happen to be one of the 53 who died in that 18-wheeler in Texas. How do you and I bridge the gap between words and actions? For the Hebrew people returning to Jerusalem, the words of promise slowly seeped into their actions. They took on the divine promise. It was not only God's vision, but it became their vision. Today, as we celebrate the gift of nation here at St. James, it's a day where we thank God for this land, we thank God for those who occupied it before us, we thank God for this experiment called democracy, which seems so fragile right now. We thank God for the incredible privilege we have of having a vote and a voice that matters, and we acknowledge that we ask God's blessing to rest on all nations of the world. And like Isaiah's promise, we too are shaped by that promise, inspired by ideals that are greater than any individual person. And we are also clothed with a task of moving from the original promise to real life fulfillment. Like the Israelites, we can't just sit around grumbling that the walls are ruined, that the temple's been destroyed, and somebody really ought to do something about it. In fact, some theologians of late believe that Scripture is calling us to be, and here's the term, co-creators with God. After all, we are, as we will experience in a moment, we are part of the body of Christ. We are Christ's hands and feet in the world. Our job is to do more than recite the Pledge of Allegiance. It's to help enact and bring reality to the words liberty and justice for all. That's not only a promise. That's our challenge. It is also our gift. It is also our privilege. But sometimes you and I can get confused and get off track. On an August night in 1892, a Baptist minister and a person who led a Christian youth group called Youth's Companion lived in Boston. His name was Francis Bellamy, and he wrote the first version of the Pledge of Allegiance that adults and school children still say today. The story of his authorship has been affirmed by the American Flag Association and by the Smithsonian Institution. They are cherished and sacred words for us, the Pledge of Allegiance. But recently, new evidence has shown that the Boston minister was perhaps not the author. A 13-year-old Kansas schoolboy probably was, whose name was also Frank Bellamy, and was said to have submitted the Pledge of Allegiance to a contest that was organized by the Boston Fred Bellamy. The goal of the contest was both patriotic and to make some hard, cold cash. Listen to the quote. "The purpose is to enlist students in the anniversary celebration to help Americanize the flood of immigrants from Southern and Eastern Europe, to heal lingering divisions from the Civil War, and to sell off the overstock of U.S. flags that Bellamy had ordered as marketing director of Youth's Companion, which was sponsoring a campaign to float a flag over every schoolhouse in the nation." End of quote. Well, that's plenty confusing. So who did write the Pledge of Allegiance? Then, an article is found in an 1892 Kansas newspaper that has the young boy's Pledge of Allegiance written. And a reference librarian at the Library of Congress then remarked, and I quote, "If Francis Bellamy of Boston wrote the pledge in August of 1892, how did it come to be published in the Kansas newspaper 3 months earlier in May of 1892? And if all that isn't enough, then the senators got into it. And the senator from Massachusetts said, it was written in my state. And the senator from Kansas said, oh, no, it was written in my state. What a mess. Today, we're still confused about the origins of the Pledge of Allegiance, but one thing is certain. While we spend our time arguing about authorship, nobody seems to be paying attention to liberty and justice for all. It gets put on the back burner. Words have eclipsed actions. Arguments have replaced meaning. And the promise of liberty and justice has not yet been fulfilled. Today, you and I celebrate the gift of nation on this holiday weekend. Here's the gift that accompanies it. We get to do so with our actions as well as our words. That, after all, would be the real wealth of nations. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you. Holy One, we thank you for this gift of nation on this 4th of July weekend. We thank you for the freedom we enjoy daily, for both our independence and our interdependence. May we never take for granted the liberties that we have been given. May we remain humble and conscious of the blessings we enjoy because of the sacrifices made by countless men and women. Help us to extend liberty and justice to all. We thank you for the abundance we enjoy. May we be sensitive to those around us who are in need, and may our hearts be quick to help when we have the means to do so. We pray for our leaders, for those placed in authority over us, our president, our governor, our legislators, our school board members. God, we ask that you would guide every decision they make. May they lead us with wisdom and humility and grace. God of all nations, bless all nations with your peace. And let your love flow through each one of us. And may we never forget to give you thanks always, Lord, in your mercy. It is with concern and love that we ask you that you would walk with the families who experienced the death of 53 in that San Antonio truck. Comfort those who experience unimaginable pain. Walk with us as Supreme Court rulings leave us with an uncertain future and our national experiment of democracy with threats. Assist those in Afghanistan dealing with the earthquake. Bring healing not only to our loved ones, but also to the nation, to our environment, to our relationships. We bring before you today, especially asking your comfort and care with Bill Hammond and with Bob Max. Lord, in your mercy, we entrust our prayers, both spoken and unspoken, into your care. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let's share some peace. Please be seated. Except for David Scott, who needs to stand because he celebrated his 29th birthday today. Happy birthday to you. Note the announcements in your bulletin. The Eco-Social Justice Committee dinner is coming up this week. Our synod has a special emphasis on Jerusalem. Follow along with those four sessions, and it's on our synod website. This week there's food boxing, and we're delighted to receive new members on the 14th of August. And if you would like to be part of that group, if you're not a member here, I encourage you to let me know or let the church office know. But you might want to hurry because I'm heading out on vacation here pretty soon for a few weeks, and then I'll be back with you as we celebrate the end of the month, the St. James the Apostle Day. So over the next few weeks, you will welcome Pastor Paul and also Pastor Vic here. And I hope you will join us after this service downstairs, 2 levels down, as we enjoy coffee together. I want you to hear now not only the meaning but the discord that comes as we celebrate this holiday weekend. Scott.
Spirit in your holy church. Our Lord Jesus Christ, the night of his betrayal, prayed. He gave thanks and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this to remember the body of Christ given for you."
Thank you.
Now send us forth for others, both friend and stranger, that all may come to know your love. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Receive the blessing. God of peace, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless and comfort you and show you the path of life today and always.